Jericho Street, 245 in progress at the borderline 99 Rolling Oaks Drive. If you're hearing gunshots fired, one person advising there's a subject inside shooting.
4th Century, we got multiple people down. We need a lot of ambulances to fire.
Station 1471, be advised there are multiple shots being fired in the back northwest area.
Audio shot fired inside borderline.
9 John, who went into the building?
4th Century, advised he went into the building.
51, 4th Century is down and unresponsive at the south entrance.
4th Century down and unresponsive, the south entrance.
51, 90751, units are evacuating 4th Century to the west parking lot.
It's evacuating 4th Century to the west parking lot.
New incident dispatch.
I pull in the middle of the street, put my car in park, and I hop out of my car real quick, and he sees me and I go, hey, you've got fire all down the side of your house here. Is everyone out of your home? I go, it's just a matter of moments before it. Again, time of day plays a big factor too. I mean, fire burns better in the daytime. There's no question about it, but if you add wind to it, it'll burn good at any time. The wind was the driving force that night. Within miles of getting there, you could see the fire from across the Oxnard Plains. It was visible to all. By anybody looking in that general direction.
He said there's a possibility. He said, I'm getting reports that we have multiple cars stacked up, trapped. He said, we have an unknown number of people up there and we have 10 fire engines up there. And he said, I'm afraid they're all getting burned over. He said, I don't know how many fatalities we're gonna have and I don't know how many firefighter fatalities we're gonna have.
This was going to be what I felt was the biggest fire we were ever gonna face. It was really a punch to the gut. When I heard on the radio, you know, we have multiple structures burning on, and they would give a name of a street that I've heard for 25 years as part of the city that I serve. That's kind of when it began, and then for the next 3 or 4 hours, I mean, every few minutes, you just heard more reports of, you know, multiple structures here, multiple structures there, and for a firefighter, that's the worst.
I was so grateful to have it because not only did I know I was getting the closest resource, which ultimately I got every resource because I needed them, I was able to track them in real time. So we have an overlaid map that's on a computer screen. So I have resource accountability to where it's 70 mile an hour winds blowing, spot fires happening a mile and a half out in front of itself, fire expanding so rapidly we couldn't draw and keep up with an accurate perimeter. But I was able to see where each of the resources were on a map, and I was able to take what they were saying, what I was hearing.
This is up Harloff Canyon. However, the fire is very active, may be dangerous for apparatus.
Center, copy and just confirm you wanted 3 type 3s, 1 type 1.
Sorry, I'm sure there'll be an order for more, but that'll get us started.
Copy.
521, did you have a name?
Affirmative, this will be Thomas Incident.
Hey, Chief, I don't have anybody for a hell attack down there at 20 Alpha. We're not going to be effective dropping on this. It's continuing to spot out ahead of it, heading for Santa Paula. But we definitely want Santa Paula Airport for our heli spot when able.
Let me give you a quick update on the fire conditions right now. We're looking at about 500 acres being pushed downhill into the city of Santa Paula. We've established two branches that'll be east and west of Highway 150 corridor. Battalion 51 will take the west side. We'll have Battalion 13 will take the east side of the Highway 150 corridor for those two branches. All equipment needs to come into the staging locations, and we'll divvy them up into the branches. We just changed mark out of the due east. Fire is pushing into Salt Marsh and towards the top end of Adams Canyon. Estimated fire size is 2,500 acres right now, spot out in front of itself, well in front of itself.
Structure group area, numerous structures have been lost, and I'm making my way back down 150 to check out the lower end of 150, what we need down there.
I want to give you a quick update on fire progress. Fire has passed Adams Canyon. I project it'll be into Wheeler Canyon within the hour. We do have some long-range spotting that's out in front. I'd like to start doing our incident planning a little bit bigger and start looking at the edge of the city of Ventura. Let's start looking at area of Clear Point and Ondolondo as well to start our little bit bigger box here on what we're looking at. Winds have picked up across the ridgetops there. Like I said, we're getting some long-range spotting across the edge of north of Foothill. There's now at about 8 to 10,000 acres, still being pushed by 50 to 60 mile an hour, strong northeast winds. Potential impacts to the city of Ventura within 2 hours. I see, copy.
It seems like every other house and then a row of 10 or 12 houses were completely lost in the fire. Now we're going to go to our satellite view from SkyMap 7, and it shows you what it looked like before the fire moved through here, and tragically all these homes were devastated and taken out. We'll go back to our live shot from Air 7 HD without the satellite, and we'll give you an idea as we pan to the right just how many homes were lost. There's hundreds of homes up in this canyon, all north of Foothill. The fire just moved through here too quickly with too much in the way of high winds to save most of these homes. But we really feel for these folks. There are, once again, hundreds of homes right in this area that were just completely destroyed.
Wednesday night in November, when 12 people were shot and killed inside that bar. Within 24 hours, more devastation here in Ventura County, and that started with the Hill Fire, which was then started by the Woolsey Fire that both took place there on November the 8th, where so many people lost their homes, they lost their belongings, and unfortunately, a couple of people also died.
I'm not a fire expert, guys, but this ain't looking good. We're probably going to want to start a pretty significant response.
With an update, we have multiple structure threats. We've utilized all our resources. Request for 10 additional Type 1 strike teams to stage to report to Oak Park High School. Also recommending we need to add some branch supervision. We're getting outpaced here.
Hold the ops. We have several people reporting trapped. All information is in the call slip. First one, 5600 Holly Tree. Have four victims surrounded by flames. Second one is a second call back from 165 Stagecoach, elderly female. Medical issues, immediate need.
Trying to get a hold of ops. We need to get another TAC channel. Is this thing squirting out into all these neighborhoods? We're going to be impacted over here momentarily. I know we're not first up right now because it's squirting out into Oak Park, but it's going to impact us here real quick. D. Charlie, Chief Ward at Lang Ranch Parkway and the dead end. We start rounding the bend here into Thousand Oaks.
Well, yes, we have report of structures on fire, Oak Park, 4875 Wiggins. We also have a report of two structures on fire in Oak Park, St. Vincent and Valero. All units in the Oak Park area of the Woolsey Fire will now be reporting to McNeil, who will be Branch 5.
What is the operation? EMS 42. I'm staged at Westlake and T.O. Boulevard. I've got three ALS and two BLS ambulances currently awaiting assignment.
Okay, I copy, and we got an acreage of 7,300 right now. L.A.'s County is making a move to evacuate south of the 101 from Las Virgenes to Canaan down to Mulholland.
On the south side of the incident, we've established four operational branches. We have Branch 4 that stretches from Los Angeles County area all the way to Lindero Canyon Road.
Break.
I have Lindero Canyon Road over to Westlake Boulevard. As from Westlake Boulevard, wrapping down around through the Lang Ranch area and into the end of Avenue de Los Arbolos. Break. 7 is a contingency branch that is looking at two different avenues of fire spread in the event fire gets established in the Debington area or in the Sunset Hills area of Thousand Oaks. Break.
Channels are assigned to your branch. Tie in with your branch director for your proper tactical channel for the geographical area you are working in. Break. Priority is life safety and victim rescue on the incident. We do not have enough resources for structural protection in and around the entire area. Evacs are taking place. Ambulances are staged at Thousand Oaks Boulevard and Westlake if you have any ambulance needs in the operating area. Break. Transmission for operations. Just keeping everybody updated on what the situation is. Our number one priority is life safety.
Fire is well established off of Sapra in the Kevington area. It is pushing hard down towards Hillcrest Drive, directly in line with Fire Station 31. It is flanking to the west towards the Herbs Road corridor.
Operations, we're starting to get calls from the Wood Ranch area stating the fire's on the Wood Ranch trailhead, cresting, about to run down the hill into Wood Ranch area.
Ventura, we'll go to the Angeles for the night flying aircraft. And also, whatever we can get out of Ventura, if we have one of our copters available.
This fire, the Woolsey fire, will take priority over the hill incident, but I just want to make sure that we do have air tankers on order. We can go 6 for both incidents with a single air attack platform, I believe, just because of overlapping TFRs.
Here at Fire Department Coffee, along with Pierce, we're all about innovation. And I tell you something, there's nothing worse than showing up on a cold day without a warm cup of coffee. So, Scott Mumford, the greatest engineer around, came up with the newest system that you're going to want on your truck. It's called the Pump and Brew 8.0. All you got to do, open up this fancy thing, add your favorite Fire Department coffee, open up the lever, and there it is, a hot, steamy cup of amazing coffee.
Fire paramedics, what's the address of the emergency?
Okay. There's a brush fire.
Okay, is that an address?
I have the address.
45 medic engine, 40 medic engine, 47. Battalion 21, patrol 20, task force 50, ticker 1, ticker 2, crew 11, cam 23, cam 20, 11, copter dozer. On a brush fire, center west Los Angeles Avenue, across of UZ, Mantu.
Ventura engine 45, we're a couple miles out. We've got a relatively large fire.
Ventura 45, it's kind of hard to tell the axis at this point, but I do have a 30 mile an hour east wind.
This is probably going to be blowing into
Tierra Rajada relatively soon.
Ventura copy engine 45, 15 acre fire access off of Tierra Rajada. Structures threatened. Engine 45, repeat your strike team needs.
This fire is going to be threatening all structures on Tierra Rajada. I think we need to start about five Type 1 strike teams. And the fire is blowing towards Tierra Rajada at this time. We're, as of right now, I'm just trying to make access.
En route, Ventura copy engine 45, requesting five Type 1 strike teams, all homes on Tierra Rajada threatened.
As you all know, the fire started this morning and was pushed by really strong east winds. The fire size right now is just a little over 1,600 acres. We have upwards of 1,000 firefighters on the line right now protecting the community. We had some significant challenges. We were trying very hard to keep it on the east side of Highway 23. It did jump the 23 corridor there, and the firefighters aggressively stood there and battled the flames. We also had some pretty significant air support come in. We have been able to at least defeat that part of the fire there and keep it from spreading towards the west. We continue to have strong winds. There's still significant...
When I opened the door, outside, the whole sky was lit up with flames.
New incident dispatch.
Engine 126, engine 142, medic engine 6, medic engine 106, medic engine 3, medic risk engine 27, water tender 4, dozer, copter 7, copter 8, Ventura crews 1 and 5, task force 50, investigator 12, battalion 24, battalion 15, brush fire off of the south mountain of the Santa Paula Airport, 320 East Santa Maria Street, command 8.
Attack on this, we may be able to keep it to the top of the ridge.
Requesting at least two working helicopters, plan for nighttime helicopters in the near future.
Copy, engine 126, we have copter 7 and copter 8, that'll be en route. This will be the Maria incident, advise on helispot, and if you want an additional engine to the helispot. Ventura, copy, two Type 3 strike team. The EPA of vehicles by ground to the ridge, 25 to 30 minutes. We have two copters en route, advise if you want additional ordered now.
Affirmative, Ventura, we'll get the two working copters, get at least two additional copters, night firefighting capabilities.
Has already requested two Type 3 engine strike teams. Ventura, copy, assistance 13, large head visible on both sides of South Mountain. Somas Branch will be Captain 57, requesting five closest engines for evacuation. Santa Paula side will be the Maria IC, engine 126 is the IC. They'll deal with fire suppression. Ventura, copy, updated acreage 750 acres.
Structures. Other than that, they've got structure protection in place, and they're ready to move resources to Sadakoy if necessary. Right now, Sadakoy does not engage in any structure protection. They got backing fire coming into their branch. Currently, I'm over in the Santa Paula branch where they're lining up resources and placing them with structures and to possibly do a burn back to the area of origin.
From that drone intrusion, as far as that was cleared off or not?
That drone, it was not from ADA Charlie. He felt he could still see the drone based on its movements, and we're still waiting for an update from SO.
About 6:15 p.m. tonight, the Maria started in the area of South Mountain. That fire was quickly spread by east winds, and it is currently at approximately 5,000 acres. We have over 400 firefighting personnel on the fire right now, and it is moving in a southwesterly direction.
There are about 1,800 structures threatened and about 7,500 people under evacuation orders at this time.
Based on the location, it's eventually going to run out of fuel. And what I mean by fuel, it's a combustible growth, the brush, the grasses. We're looking at maybe 12,000 acres at the biggest footprint on this.
They've been doing such an incredible, incredible job, like just all the coordinated efforts, and so we're really grateful.
But it is a calling for us. It is our, we are sworn to protect, and that's what we do. I'm checking my vital signs, my battle lines going to war again. Feeling the rhythm inside of my chest, all I need is just a plan. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this. Don't care for the critics, my words and life physics are force that they can't stop. They just don't get it, I think if I get my tongue till I'm on top. I know.
I face the doubts I hide. I never gave in to my faith, people think as I hold my voice inside. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this. I will never lose my voice. If I cut out all the noise, I know I was born for this. I know.
Mistakes, don't ever lose your hope. Just know you were born for this. Just know you were born for this. We are the warriors who learn to love the pain. We come from different places but have the same name. Cause we were, cause we were, cause we were, cause we were born for this. We were born for this. We are the broken ones who chose to spark the flame. Watch as our fire rages, our hearts are never tame. Cause we were, cause we were, cause we were, cause we were born for this. We were born for this.
A 38-year-old Ryan Osler was killed in the line of duty. That happened this morning.
Engineer Osler was in the passenger seat of this water truck when it rolled over on a roundabout on 246 outside of Lompoc this morning. He was headed to battle the canyon fire on Vandenberg Air Force Base. Osler was an 18-year veteran of the department.
He's not new. He's been around a long time. He watched his father work for us for a lot of years.
Osler's dad was also an engineer for the department at the same firehouse. He died of work-related health issues. The 38-year-old father leaves behind a wife and two young kids.
Well, one of the things I think stood out with me was how good he was at his job, how dedicated, but at the same time how he knew when it was time to say, nope, time to go home and I got a family and that kind of stuff.
And when you talk to firefighters here, they tell you that even though it's a big department in some ways, in others, it's like a small family. They all know each other, even the ones that aren't in these same fire stations. The last time a firefighter died in the line of duty here in Ventura County was 1991.
Ventura County, 4-21, be route.